Tonight's beverage is Gentleman's Stout from Medicine Hat Brewing Company in Medicine Hat, Alberta. They describe it as having a rich coffee and semi-sweet chocolate flavor, predominant with a slightly burnt presence. Yeah, that's a nice roasty flavor in there. I like that. I also like the can, too. That's pretty nice. So today, I'm going to be playing with and tinkering with and exploring this little DMX-controlled stage light that I got from eBay. Specifically, the absolutely cheapest DMX-controlled stage light that I could find on eBay or AliExpress or Banggood or any of the usual scumbags. Because I didn't obviously want it for stage lighting. I just want it as something that can talk DMX and that I can experiment with and play with. And just for shits and giggles, tear down and see what's inside it too. Which I think is where I'm going to start. I won't be too destructive so that I can actually play with it though, because I do want it to survive as an experimental platform. As you can see, this thing has a dozen LEDs on the front of it. It's an RGBW, so there's three red, three green, three blue, and three white, the ones in the middle. And on the back, it has a couple of connectors and a little display with some buttons. The connectors are just labeled DMX in and DMX out. These are 3-pin XLR, which are not the proper connector for DMX 512 protocol. The protocol specifies a 5-pin connector so that you can't accidentally plug the wrong thing into it, because this 3-pin XLR is commonly a microphone cable or an audio cable. Also, the spec calls for a specific impedance of cable which does not match standard audio cables. But the cheap ones almost always have the 3-pin XLR on them, just because cheapness. And down here we have a display which is horribly flickery. So right now it's in address mode. It's showing that its address is 1. The DMX protocol allows you to just daisy chain the control from one light to another and set each one to a unique address, and then you can just talk to them. That's a fairly standard kind of a concept these days for controlling all manner of equipment, but back in the late 80s, early 90s, it kind of revolutionized how lighting was done. So the things that you can do on that little control panel, well, first of all, you can set the address. You can manually control the red, green, and blue, and white to different levels. There is, what is that? You got red and blue and white on. So you can go through and set each of them to their own thing. There is also a strobe mode and an automatic mode. So there's the automatic mode. There's the strobing mode. You can sort of see that through the shutter. But it's... is it all of them strobing? No, it's not strobing the greens for some reason, or the reds rather. Okay, so there's sound activated mode. So as your bass heavy disco music thumps along, it just does that with a built-in microphone, which I assume is in through that little hole there. Not much else that the manual says. Keep it dry, using it intermittently can extend your life. Gee, if you don't use it as often, it'll last longer. Wow. Attention to clean the fan. Oh yeah, it's got a fan in it. You probably hear that. It's actually louder than I would expect it to be, but anyway. Please do not wipe the crust using organic menstruum for avoid to damage the product. I think it's screwdriver time. There are 2, 3, 4 screws around there. One thing I noticed when I was messing with it earlier is one of the screws isn't even really doing anything. Is it even in there? No, it isn't. So I will do this and quickly cut to getting the last screw out, because this is boring. there's the four screws out, and the LED panel just comes off the front. There's why the front was coming out. These two screws were running so hard at the factory that they pulled right through. Wow. This thing just screams quality, doesn't it? Okay, so the LED board looks like it's just plugged on with a four conductor little plug onto there. See if I can get down in there. I can't get my grubby paws in there, but I should be able to pull it out this way, I hope. Okay, not a locking connector. There's the DMX connector board. It is just the two connectors, the in and the out, in parallel with the three wires going off to that connector down there by the looks of it. And this is completely normal for them to be paralleled, even in the fancier fixtures. Some really high-end ones might have a buffer amplifier in there just to isolate stuff, but I wasn't expecting that in here. So we have two other things going on here. We have the little fan, which is just tie wrapped in the bottom here, or zip tied, and they didn't even cut them flush. I guess they weren't expecting anybody to go in here. So that's plugged on there. This plug jumps between what I assume is the power supply board. Yeah, that's the power supply board, and the control board, which is hiding back behind there. Okay, we will dig further. That's the fan up there, and I guess I'll pull that one off there. So these are keyed, but they're not locking. It's a little bit naughty of me to be yoinking on the cable, but they didn't leave much room. I wonder what that 3-pin connector over there is for. Some kind of an added option. Oh man, these screws into the plastic are just a mess. There's shredded plastic coming out all over the place. Whoever put this in the first place obviously used a drill or something. So there's the power board. The AC line coming in there, just tacked on, not even through the holes. We have a little glass fuse there, which is labeled as 2 amp 250 volt. And then we have bridge rectifier on the back, smoothing capacitors, a little power supply chip, standard little cheap switch mode power supply, basically. Power supply control chip there, the opto-isolator for feedback, a couple of smoothing capacitors, a bypass capacitor, class Y capacitor there, hopefully. Can't see a marking on it. Let's just assume that they've vaguely done it right, or at least pretended. Yeah, the transformer for the to pass the high frequency AC through. There's no MOSFET or anything doing the chopping. It's all done inside the chip. That's interesting. Anyways, on the output side, or on the low voltage side, we have a single diode and a single capacitor. 470 microfarads, 16 volts. Then the power that goes to the fan, or to the main board on the back there, and the fan power. That is it. Oh, there's a couple of diodes in the back of here too, and a resistor. Okay. 104 10K resistor. But basically nothing too special about that. Just a cheap little switching power supply. And here is the main board that controls everything. We have three chips on there. Voltage regulator says 7805 right on it. We got four transistors driving the four channels of lights over here. Some brain boxing going on there. There is the microphone, pushy buttons, and the little display. What do we have on here for chips? 74HC164. Okay, that's a shift register. Serial in, parallel out. Okay, that's straightforward enough. And next to that, BL3085. Not familiar with him.
Couldn't find an English data sheet, but it shows up in this one as an RS485 transceiver type chip, which makes perfect sense because RS485 is the physical standard that DMX512 is built on top of.
And then there's this little bit of brain boxery going on up at the end here. What an enormous part number. I will see what Google can find.
I guess that shouldn't be a surprise to anybody. It is a microcontroller. An 8-bit microcontroller. 16 megahertz, 18K of user code memory, 17 GPIO, 2 full duplex UART ports, one of which is going to be talking to that RS485 chip and receiving the DMX signal. It's got I2C and SPI. And it has 6 channels of PWM outputs. This application is using 4 of those to drive the lights. I didn't see it talking about an ADC though. Oh no, there it is down there. Okay. It also has, looks like 8 channels of ADC input. So one of those will be going to the microphone, or probably a little amplifier transistor after the microphone. And fairly cheap, too, when you buy them in quantity. Wow. I wonder what kind of a programming tool... No,
I'm not going down that road. Nope.
But this is a damn cheap chip. Maybe not as cheap as that... Was it 6-cent or 12-cent one that Dave Jones found? But damn.
Oh, yeah. There's a little transistor beside the microphone. No doubt amplifying that for one of those analog inputs. And other than that, there's not a lot going on here. I guess I'll pop this off and just see what those LEDs are. I think they're a little 3 watts. I'm expecting kind of those star type ones, I think. Okay, it all lifts up as a unit. Ah, they're not even the star ones, but they are... I guess they are the basic same LED as what you find on those little star boards. Neat little lens packages here too. Just snap back down over top of there somehow. Yeah, the friction fit. Okay. So those are replaceable. That is a fairly standard LED. So now I guess I will just put this guy all back together. And I may have to rewind and just take a look at where some of those connectors go, because I wasn't paying that close attention to it. That was more yakking. But when I've got it back together, I'll fire it back up and play with it a bit more. After a certain amount of screwing around, I have come up with this fine demonstration circuit here. We have an Arduino Nano. We have an RS485 board based on the MAX485 chip on one of these little modules here. I have 5 potentiometers, 4 just normal rotary pots, and 1 fancy slide pot connected to analog inputs. The TX pin on the Arduino is connected to the data in on this little MAX board. The 2 enable lines are pulled high. What else have I got? And then I've got the DMX cable connected to just the pins on the breadboard. I could have had it connected to the screw terminals, but the pins are just quicker and easier. And then I have some hacky code that I threw together based on copy and pasting out of one of the examples. And there we go. We have a master DIM. And I have a red and a green and a blue and a white control. So I can put whatever I want in there and then do a master dim on them like that. If I had a bunch of these, I definitely would have used it because it would have looked a lot more like a traditional lighting console. But this is what I have right now. As you might expect, I've got a bunch more of those on order.
Might as well go through the code that I threw together for this. Bear in mind, this is almost entirely from this library, the Arduino DMX library, which has a dependency on the Arduino RS-485 library. So I just took their demo fade sketch and basically multiplied it 6 times. And I don't actually need the sixth one. I only really need five. But I left that sixth one in there just because. I created the brightness variables, set them to zero. That fade amount is left over from the demo sketch. It doesn't matter. DMX begin tells the library to start. I set the brightnesses based on an analog read of the analog inputs and then scaled them. And then, again, library called DMX begin transmission, and then write to the six channels, the six brightnesses, and end. And that's it. This is such a simple little library. There's a few more things it can do, but that is the absolute basics of it. And then all this commented out stuff is just the stuff from the library example that I was too lazy to remove. This isn't the only DMX library that there is in the Arduino Library Manager, and there's some others that you can search for as well, but this one just was the simplest one that I could find to get this going for a demonstration today.
With just some very basic hardware, I can control this light, which is excellent because the next thing I want to do, and it's another experiment for another day, but I want to try and build the other half of this, basically build my own light using, you know, whatever, the sky's the limit. You can put any kind of a light you want in it. LED strips or some individual ones with these, which as we discovered are the lights that are in there, or that, or some of these, or bigger, whatever, because that's just a low voltage control signal, and anything that an Arduino can control, which is literally anything, I could control this way. One thing I've noticed about this light, both when it's dimming on its own internal automated patterns and when I'm doing this, is its dimming steps are very discrete and obvious. It's not smooth like you would hope or expect. On the other hand, it's not showing a lot of PWM flicker, which is good. That is quite bright when it's shining straight in your face, which is what it is doing right now. But for on a proper stage, it would get lost unless you had a whole bunch of them. And I mean, at the cost, which was $10 American or $13.50 Canadian when I bought it, as I said, it was the absolute cheapest DMX light that I could find on eBay at the time. So, well, that was a fun little exploration and a bit of learning on my part. This is probably old hat for some of you. I know a lot of other people have gone down this path, but I tend to learn better when I actually do it and play with it and make mistakes, which I did quite a lot of, which are hopefully going to end up on the editing room floor, the virtual editing room floor. Anyway, thanks for watching. Questions and comments down below as usual. I'm kind of excited to get back into playing with this kind of stuff, because when I was working with stage lighting decades and decades ago, DMX was just new technology and only really the big boys had it. Those of us where we're schlepping lighting systems and sound systems into crappy bars never got to play with that kind of cool stuff. So now's my chance to at least explore it a little bit anyways. Well, thanks for watching. I will talk to you later.